Hi, I'm Mike Sughrue. I'm a neurosurgeon and co-founder of Omniscient. And today we're going to talk about brain networks. How are they structured? What do they do? Why are they important? And how is this a change and departure from what we thought about how the brain works in the past? For a long time, clinicians and scientists had thought about the brain in a very simple way, where a part of the brain had a specific function, like language or motor. More recent evidence has shown that the situation is far more complicated and is best thought about as the concept of a brain network, which are areas of the brain that may or may not be next to each other that work together to create a common task. And the anatomy and science of brain networks has really taken us substantially forward in understanding and beginning to tackle higher cognitive functions, which are far more complex than just moving your arm or leg. It's important to start simple. And ultimately, the brain can be summarized as a combination of gray matter, which you see is the outer surface and deeper structures in the brain, where the brain cells live, and white matter, which is a series of connections between those areas in the inner core of the brain. While the white matter looks simple, we know that it's extraordinarily complex. Specifically, it is billions and billions of connections between different parts of the gray matter. And ultimately, while it can often be very simple in certain places, in many cases you have wires crossing and many wires going back and forth between different areas. And so understanding the relationship between different parts of the gray matter and what is the exact anatomy of the white matter is really at the center of 21st century neuroscience. The Human Connectome Project gave us a tool for being able to break this down into simple, understandable components. Seen here is their parcellation scheme. And parcellation refers to the technique of determining and giving names to the surface of the brain based on areas that do different things. And from this kind of techniques, it became clear that oftentimes parts of the brain that were immediately next to each other were doing radically different things, or even part of different networks. And as a result, it ultimately became clear that our understanding of different parts of the brain being the math or language areas was overly simplistic. And this led to the concept of a brain network. We began to recognize that there were parts of the brain, often on opposite sides of the brain or at significant distances from each other, that were firing together. They were firing on the same time courses. And we eventually learned that this was, in many cases, due to the fact that these areas shared connections with each other. They were wired together. Things that fire together wire together. As we began to study this deeper, it became more evident that the reason these areas were firing together was they were serving a common set of functions. But in many cases, different parts of networks could work together to make more complicated functions, such as mathematics, speech, etc. And that these networks weren't all equal. There were some networks whose job it was to sit at the top of the hierarchy and tell other networks what they should be doing, how they should be processing information, etc., to achieve the goals of cognitive function. And this has substantially and radically changed our understanding about how the brain really works.